Good morning. Are we on there? Yes. I always like to comment on the videos. From now on, the videos are all going to be from the town of Ollantaytambo in the Sacred Valley near Cusco, Peru. This is a festival that takes place roughly 50 days after Easter Sunday, so about 7.5 weeks later. It is their local festival. It lasts 4 days. It's basically a four-day drunk. There are anywhere from 12, 13, sometimes 14 different dance groups that are dancing, and each of the videos will be a specific dance group. And one dance group among those 12 or 14 or so is dancing all the time. So 3 o'clock in the morning, somebody is dancing in front of the church. Yesterday, when I started, some of you may have heard I gave a little bit of my background in terms of where I had my degrees and so forth. The one thing I forgot to mention yesterday is that it's always tough for me to come on cruises like this and be away from a home. I have twin three-year-olds at home. And, you know, I look around the room, and I think probably most of you don't have little kids at home. But maybe you can remember back, or maybe you've got kids, grandkids probably, great-grandkids. You know they grow up so fast. And when you're away from home any length of time, in this case I'm gone for 40-some days, they grow up. Somebody asked me one time when I mentioned this, did I have any pictures? And at the time I didn't, but now I've remembered to bring some pictures. So I did bring some pictures this time. Let's see if it'll work here. Yeah, there's Bam Bam, and there's Trouble. Twin three-year-olds. Now, some of you have heard my lectures before on the previous cruise, and I mentioned there that I had a four-year-old, but that was my horse. Today's lecture is Batan, Grande, and the Sican Gold. And I'm willing to bet that most of you have never heard of this archaeological site and know anything about it. It's one that has not gotten as much publicity as it should have gotten. This is the coast of Peru, and we're going to be talking about the North Coast region. In actuality, right now, we are about right there. If you go back and look at the map on your TV, you'll see exactly where we are. We're off the North Coast of Peru right now. We've come from Lima. We're heading up to Guayaquil. A little bit closer view, there's Lima, and the North Coast is consisting of a series of irrigated river valleys. The Moche Valley, we should be in the Moche Valley right today. The largest city in the Moche Valley is Trujillo, where we should have stopped today. And there's Trujillo. And then the Chicama Valley. Actually, I've done a lot of work, and I've lived in the Chicama Valley a lot. And then Jequetepeque, and one called the Lambayeque Oasis. And it's going to be the Lambayeque Oasis that we'll be talking about today. The coast of Peru, from the Ecuadorian border, continuing all the way into the Atacama down to north-central Chile, is a desert. And it is a dry, dry desert. Trujillo, for example, has an average of 1 inch of rainfall per year, but that's a totally phony statistic. What it is they go 9 years without any, and then 1 year they get 10, and that averages out to 1 inch. This year is one of those years that they're getting a lot of rain, just like California is getting. Lima has flooding. Trujillo has flooding. I've got some videos friends have sent me of one of the malls in Trujillo with water flowing through it. But it's a very, very dry area. Almost no vegetation, except where you have a river coming out of the mountains. The rainfall is up in the mountains or is coming from glaciers up in the mountains. So whenever you have a river coming down, you have an irrigated oasis. And in point of fact, the agriculture in this area within the irrigated valleys is among the most productive anywhere in the world. The soils are fantastic, and you have year-round growing season. You're close to the equator and stuff, so it's a very, very productive agricultural area. Here's a little bit closer Google Earth image, and we're going to be talking about the Lambayeque Oasis. in this image, the lighter brown color here, that's desert, no vegetation at all. But where you have rivers coming out of the mountains, you do have agricultural land. So these darker colors here, that's irrigated agriculture. And the largest city in this area is a city called Chiclayo, a little bit smaller than Trujillo. And I want to point out one other little town, a town called Ferrañafe. We'll be going to Ferrañafe a little bit later. Here's a closer view. Again, the darker color on the left, that's irrigated agriculture. On the right, those are the coastal hills, part of the desert. And there's Ferrañafe. And this is the La Leche River Valley there up at the top that we'll be focusing in on. And within that area, there is a national reserve or national park called Pomac, and it's about right there. And specifically, the area that we'll be talking about is going to be into the Pomac National Reserve. Now, again, this is a desert, but whenever you have water coming out of the mountains, you have the potential for vegetation. And the natural vegetation in Pomac are a series of trees that you see here. This is a video I made in 2020, and we're just going along one of the roads here in the reserve. Notice that many of the trees have vines growing all over them. All that stuff is dead, actually. The vines pop up whenever there's an El Nino rain. So every 7 or 10, 12 years, when there's one of these heavy rains, vegetation becomes very, very lush. And then in the intervening years, it all dies out. And it's just dry like you see here. The trees are a type that have very, very deep tap roots. They go down into the groundwater. But Pomac is a pretty spectacular area. There's a lot of different animals in here, foxes, and actually there's some bears in this area, in the hills. And that's one of the entrances to the Pomac National Reserve. Notice the sign, it says Batan Grande. Batan Grande was an hacienda that in the old days used to own the whole area of the Pomac Reserve. And here's a 1880s photograph, late 1800s photograph of the hacienda Batan Grande. It got the name Batan Grande. Batane is a piece of stone that you could grind stuff on. And that there is a batan. And this is the stone that you would rock back and forth, and you could grind up stuff to make flour and things like that. So you see here somebody using a batan to make some sort of paste. But it gets that name not only from grinding things like food products, but also crushing ore. The area around Batan Grande has alluvial gold in some of the rivers, and they would use things like this to crush the rock to extract the minerals, particularly gold. So again, here's a little bit lower view Google Earth image, and the hacienda that we were just looking at is there, but they originally had all of this territory here to the left of the actual hacienda buildings that's now the Pomac Reserve. And here we're walking, no longer driving, but I'm walking along one of the roads within the reserve. And if we look just a little to the left, we see something. Now, those of you who have heard a couple of my previous lectures on the last cruise saw this particular slide, and I want to talk about three different words. The word waka in Peru refers to a sacred spot, and it's often used to refer to pyramids, adobe brick pyramids, like we saw right at the end of the last little video. It could also refer to a hill that has some sacred importance or a cemetery, things like that. The word waco, with an O at the end, refers to a ceramic pot that are typically found in sacred places, like cemeteries or adobe brick pyramids, or sometimes in the remains of high-status residences, if you find it archaeologically. Wacos in wacas are usually found by vaqueros. Vaqueros are grave robbers. And in the Pomac Forest, in Batan Grande, in the old hacienda, vaqueros operated for years and years and years. In fact, in the period prior to about 1968, from maybe the 1950s on, the owners of the hacienda Batan Grande actually had commercial scale looting. They were not just fly-by-night looters working at night, but these guys that owned the hacienda simply went out and started looting huacas in their territory on a commercial scale. So again, here's the Google Earth image of the area. And the Sican huacas that I'm going to talk about are located there, just within the old Batan Grande hacienda. Or here's a little bit closer view. The river here is called the La Leche River, and there are a number of big huacas in this area. First one is Huaca La Merced, I'm not going to talk about today. Huaca Colorado, I probably won't talk about much. Huaca Loro or El Oro, you'll see different spellings. It's either El Oro, which means the gold, or Loro, which means parrot, but both words are used. And Huaca Las Ventanas and Huaca Corte. There's six major huacas there. Huaca Rodeo is the sixth one there. So there are six major huacas in this spot. And you can see the forest there. First one I'll start here with is Huaca Corte. Up through the late 1960s, nobody really could get into Batan Grande. The family that owned the hacienda kept everybody out because they were looting on an industrial scale. In the late 70s, a couple of archaeologists began to do a little bit of work here, and the first excavations took place in 1980 at Huaca Corte. Now, the guy that's going to be involved in our story is a man named Azumi Shimada. He did his doctoral dissertation in this area, but not at Batan Grande in 77, 78, and he decided he wanted to do excavations here. A friend of mine in back in Trujillo, where I was working in the summer of 1980, we decided to go up and visit Azumi. We knew had known Azumi for a couple of years, and so we decided to go up and visit him at his excavations at Batan Grande. So the next few photos are ones that I took in 1980, and when we first arrived, when we walked to this site, we literally had to walk from the hacienda, the old hacienda that was the research headquarters, out to the site. We walked along and we were seeing these big, big holes. These are not archaeological excavations here. These are looters' pits. That's done by looters. This is not some fly-by-night looter that just dug a hole in the ground. These were nicely done archaeological excavations done by professional looters. And they also use bulldozers. You can almost see here the tracks of bulldozers going back and forth across a huaca that they literally destroyed trying to find something. And they did find lots of stuff. Some of the material that's in the Gold Museum in Lima came out of this site in the 50s and 60s and early 70s. This is the pyramid that Azumi Shimada was excavating in 80. And it had already been partially looted by looters, but he began to do some excavations. It's an adobe brick pyramid, so it's simply adobe blocks piled on top of each other to make this thing. And this is some of his excavations. That's me in 1980, so what, 43 years ago. And it's one of his workmen digging. That's Azumi Shimada on the left and my friend Don Skillman next to him. That we'd come up here, Don and I had gone up there together to visit Azumi. And that's Azumi down in his excavation, a young man at the time. The adobe bricks were interesting. Many of the adobe bricks had marks on them, and you see a little curlicue that somebody had pressed into the adobe brick while it was still soft. You dry these in the sun and they become hard. There's one that has an X drawn into the adobe brick. Or there's one that hasn't been completely excavated, but you can see there's some sort of little sign on that. We call these things maker's marks, and as somebody made a bunch of bricks, they would put their same mark on all of them, and when a group of people paid taxes, they paid taxes either in labor or product of labor, and they would have their bricks marked that they made those bricks, and they would pile them up, and that's how they paid their taxes to whoever was collecting the taxes to build this pyramid. Let's talk a little bit about the Sican culture. Some of you heard my lecture on the Moche on the previous thing, the previous voyage. Moche culture ended about 750 AD. The Sican begin right after the Moche, so their earliest evidence is around 800 current era or AD. The classic part of their culture is from about 900 to about 1100 AD or current era. And they fade out in 1370s or so. They were conquered by a culture called the Chimu that then was the dominant culture on the north coast from the 1200s up through the 1460s or 1470s, when they in turn were conquered by the Inca. So we're talking here is going to be mainly about classic Middle Sican 900 to about 1100 AD. I mentioned wakos, the ceramic pots. Some of you have seen either in a museum when we visited Lima or from my lecture, you know the Moche had really, really nice pots. The Sican pots are not quite as good. They're not as colorful. They're not as well painted. But that's a typical Sican pot. They're typically one spout with a handle on the back. And the distinguishing characteristic is many of them have the face that you see there, the figure, and supposedly that's one of their gods, but the most distinguishing characteristic is going to be the eyes. We refer to them as comma-shaped eyes, and that's the Sican eye that you'll see again and again and again. These all blackware pots, and again, not as good as the Moche pots from a little bit earlier time period, but with that very distinctive face, and you can see the comma-shaped eye over there. So these are all typical Sican pots. Here's one that's a double spout with a bridge connecting them, and there's a representation of the same pot, but not in ceramic. This one is in gold, and they made a ritual offering of a imitation Sican pot for some high-status burial. The area around where Sican is found does have a lot of alluvial gold, placer gold, and they did a lot with gold. The reason why the looters were going after their tombs because they were very, very rich tombs in terms of gold. This is a drinking cup about 7 or 8 inches high. I have held several of these in my hand. They weigh perhaps almost a pound. Think in terms of what a pound of gold would be worth. But lots of these things. Again, that comma-shaped eye. These are upside down, but seeing it. They did good gold work. The other thing that is found in some of the tombs that the looters were after, and these next pictures are taken from museums. These are things that are in museums around the world. They are large face masks. They are typically perhaps 15, maybe 18 inches wide. They're made of copper and gold. They do have that distinctive comma-shaped eye. These were placed on the outside of a mummy bundle. A dead person would be wrapped up in many, many layers of cloth, and then on the outside of that bundle that you would have, they would tack one of these things on approximately where the face would have been. And many of them were excavated by the looters and are now found in museums around the world. The last thing I'll show you, this is referred to as a tumi knife. It's really not usable. It's copper with gold on it. But things like this of bronze would be used for sacrifices, for human sacrifices. Tumi knife was the object used. And that would be about, this one here, probably about 22, 24 inches high. You've probably seen something like this on posters of Peru. One of the best Tumi knives in the National Museum is one of the icons of Peruvian archaeology, and you see it in postcards and posters and all sorts of images of Peruvian archaeology. So many of them have been found in these high-status burials that the looters excavated. So. We've just looked at Huacacorte that Zumi was excavating in 1980. In the later in the 80s, kind of 88, 89 or so, they excavated Huaca Las Ventanas. And here's a view of it. That's Huaca Las Ventanas there. It's a big, big adobe brick pyramid. There it is again. Oops. And there's a sign that leads to it. It's just a pile of adobe bricks. It has been partially reconstructed. This front area here has been partially reconstructed. The excavation here was done by Izumi along with a Peruvian. Usually these days you have to have a Peruvian as co-director of any project, and the co-director on this project was Carlos Alera. Now, I taught at the Catholic University in Lima in 81, 82, 84, 85, and in, I think, 1984, Carlos was one of my students at the Catholic University. He later on went on and got his PhD from the University of Calgary and is a good Peruvian archaeologist. But this is back here with this photo is one I found on the web of him, I think, from about 88 or 89 when they were excavating this Huaca. Okay, we've looked at Ventanas. The next one I want to talk about, and we're going to spend a lot of time with, is Huaca Loro or El Oro. Both names are used. You'll see both names. And it's that one right there. Notice the river on the right-hand side. This is an air photo done when it was a rainy year. And again, that's Huaca Loro right there. And there's the river in a normal year, totally dry. And the Huaca in the background, but it's a totally dry river. And on occasion, maybe once every 8 or 10 years or so, it will have some water in it, which it does this year. Those are some guys pointing out to the river. It is just unusual to see it there. So there's our Huaca Loro or El Oro. And Izumi Shimada started to do some excavations around here in 1991. This is a model from a local museum I'll talk about later. The thing inside that plastic plexiglass thing is what the Huaca is today, and the plexiglass represents what the Huaca might have looked like. It has this long ramp that extends out to the north of it. But that inside the plexiglass is what is left today. When it does rain here, which is only every 6 or 8, 10 years, an adobe brick pyramid is sort of like melting ice cream, and it sort of washes away with the occasional rains. So here's a drawing of the Huaca, and we have this ramp or platform that goes off to the north. In 1991, Izumi Shimada began an excavation on the east side of that ramp that you see there. In 1995, he did a second excavation on the opposite side of that platform or ramp. In this model, there's the east excavation and there's the west excavation. And this is a sign that you see there today that indicates where the excavations were. The east excavation is on that side, and the west excavation is there. So here's just the beginnings of excavation and beginning to go down. There's actually a burial there and going down further and further and further. That's Izumi now on the left-hand side. This is 1991, so he's 11 years older than we saw him in 1980. He originally was teaching at Princeton, then he was teaching at Harvard. Most of his career has been at Southern Illinois, and he's now an emeritus professor at Southern Illinois.
Para conocer la estructura social de esta cultura, tuvo que excavarse una tumba de la clase alta.
So there's Wakaloro, or El Oro.
Seleccionando Wakaloro,
and this is what the excavation of the East Tomb looked like initially. They have to cut down the trees. That's Izumi. And digging down further and further, begin to find some burials.
Salió primero un ornamento de oro. Evidentemente, fue la tumba de un
headdress. That's Izumi.
Avanzando la excavación, se iba aclarando su misteriosa estructura. En cuya parte superior se
ultimately they hit a large tomb.
Y en la parte más profunda se hallaron dos mujeres jóvenes dispuestas una frente a la otra.
Two young women and then a young male. There's the mask.
La tumba con una máscara, extrañamente enterrado de cabeza.
And it was on a around a
fue la máscara con los ojos alados. El
mummy
bundle demostró su hipótesis. Aquí vemos la estructura de la tumba este de Wakaloro.
So now we're looking at the east tomb in a model.
Es un pozo de 11 metros de profundidad, en cuyo fondo se ubicó
la gran tumba. About 33 feet deep, and there were a series of burials in it.
En la esquina noroeste de la cámara funeral había una caja de estera que contenía unos 60 objetos de
gold.
Encima de las andas fue enterrada una niña de 12 o 13 años.
A young woman of about 12 or 13 years old.
Estaba enterrado el personaje
below
principal.
Below that person, there was a high-status individual wrapped in a mummy bundle. The mummy bundle was gone, but the skeleton was still there. That person, high-status individual, was upside down for some reason. So you've got the high-status person in the middle there. This is stuff that came out of the tomb. These are bronze digging sticks or spear points, and this is cleaning some of the stuff.
Se ejecutó una restauración larga y perseverante.
A lot of gold came out of here.
La tumba este de Wakaloro es una de las tumbas llenas de oro más grandes de Sudamérica.
This is some of the stuff that came out of that tomb. Gold crown. There's our little Sican figure on some of it. These are ear spools, ear decorations. There's one of the headdresses. There's the mask. This is how the excavation, again, 33 feet down until they got to the main part of the tomb. And that's Izumi up there on the top. And that's him again. And this is going down to the main part of the tomb where they found the figure upside down. Typical Sican ceramics and stuff. And that's a model of it. This guy was inside a mummy bundle, so he wasn't just in that position, but he was inside a mummy bundle, and for some reason, they put the mummy bundle in upside down. Very, very bizarre. But he wasn't like this, but he was wrapped up in layers of cloth. His mask, however, is properly oriented, so whether they did that deliberately for some reason, hard to say. And that's the representation of some of the stuff that came out of the tomb.
Considerando este sistema,
after that,
el doctor Shimada
4 years later, 1995,
Izumi
there begins to do a second excavation on the other side of the platform or ramp.
Se emprendió la excavación del lado oeste de la plataforma.
And they start to dig down. Notice how they have to shovel dirt from one guy up to the next level, to the next, to the next, to the next, to get it out of there. They begin to work their way down.
Continuando la excavación, se encontraron unos nichos.
Come to a big tomb. There are a number of burials in little niches around the tomb.
Restos humanos.
This one is about 35 feet deep.
Se hallaron pozos en el fondo. Y en cada uno estaban enterradas una o dos mujeres jóvenes.
There's a main part of the tomb down here that had a central area, and then around that were 12 small kind of deposits, six on one side, six on the other, each of which contained one or two females. So there's looking down into 36 feet down to the main part of the tomb.
Por fin se rescató al señor de la tumba,
and in
la
the
parte más
central
profunda.
Part, there is a single high-status male,
en su rostro,
again with a face
llevaba
mask.
La máscara con los ojos alados. Estamos viendo la estructura de la tumba oeste
this
de
is a model that's now going to show us that tomb.
En el suelo, a 12 metros de profundidad, se ubica la primera cámara funeral, cuyas paredes contienen 10 nichos. Y se encontraron dos mujeres jóvenes y un niño.
There were niches around the side
en el suelo
of the tomb with three burials, and then there were 12 of these little burials or coffers or tombs,
una o dos mujeres
with
jóvenes.
Each of the 12 having one or two females in it.
En la cámara
and in the central, there was one male, high-status male,
de una mujer joven.
Small a female
nicho,
there, and another female there.
Y en el centro estaba sentado el señor de la tumba con la máscara. Aún descubriendo la tumba oeste, el significado del entierro boca abajo sigue siendo enigmático.
Okay, here's a drawing or sketch of it, and there were these 12 little chambers around him, six on one side, six on the other, and
se descubrió sucesivamente
in each one of those little chambers, 12 of them were one or two females.
Las mujeres de edad aproximada, supuestamente
six on one side, six
linaje.
On another.
Tal vez sean hermanas o primas.
And here's a drawing of it. So there's central tomb. Six little chambers on one side, six on the other side, with females, one or two in each of those little chambers. There's a total of, I think, 24 burials in this tomb. There's our central chamber with the 12 little tombs around it. On this one, the circles or triangles or diamonds, squares, represent people whose DNA was in a single lineage. And this is matrilineal DNA. So when you see two black circles there, those people are related through their mother. They're either cousins or perhaps daughter and mother, daughter, grandmother, but somehow they're related there. You see there's a bunch that are the open circles. So there are four of those over here and a couple over here. But those two circles, there's nobody on the left that is from that lineage. There's some black squares. Nobody on the left is from the black square lineage. The diamonds and triangles over here, they're on this side, but not on that side. There are a couple of extra burials that are from one or another of the lineages. Within the central chamber, there are two females, and these are all females, except for the central guy. There's one over here that's tied in with a circle lineage, and there's one over on the other side that's tied in with the other lineage. There are in total six lineages identified, female lines in this tomb. They appear to be sacrifice peoples, whether they were female wives of his, what, we don't really know. But the excavation here is recent enough in the 90s, and the work has been going on them so that we now have some DNA stuff that we don't have for many of the other sites in Peru. That's one of the headdresses and mask. There's a close-up on his mask. There's what the guy might have looked like with one of his headdresses. There are actually three different headdresses found in that tomb. Ear spools. There's two of the headdresses. This is a drawing of what he might have looked like in seated on a little throne. Lots of shell. The shell on the left is spondylus. Spondylus is a warm water shell. It's found from Ecuador up to Mexico. We do know that the time period here is right. There was trading contact between coastal Peru up to Mexico on rafts. There's Spondylus. It's coming from a ways away. These are some of the, again, objects that were found in the tomb there. These are ear spools. Your ear decorations are always an indication in Peruvian archaeology of very high status people. Gold. So, Ferenyafe is the closest town to the Sican, the Poma area. And with Zumi Shimada as a co-director on this project, Zumi is of American citizen but of Japanese ancestry, and with money from Japan, they have built a wonderful museum at Ferenyafe for the Sican materials. So almost all the stuff that was excavated in the East and West tomb have ended up here. Again, Carlos was my student back in 1984. We've been good friends ever since. So whenever I'm up on the North Coast, I try to visit him. There's Carlos. I've taken a variety of tour groups up there. This is an Archaeological Institute of America tour group, and this was a private tour group that I had with Carlos there in the center. And this is our group going through the museum. It's an absolutely wonderful museum, very, very well done, up to all modern museum standards. So we've looked now at Huacaloro as our last spot, and we've looked at Ventanas and Huacacorte. The one left one here that I haven't talked about is Huacarodiana, and it's there. And this is Huacarodiana area, and there's the Huaca. And there's a little bit closer view. And here on the right of it, just the beginnings of an excavation. This is in 2020, I think January of 2020. And using ground-penetrating radar, Zumi had done work in here, had a team come in and use ground-penetrating radar. They are pretty sure there is a fancy tomb, actually two fancy tombs, here at Huacarodiana. So this is just the beginning of the excavation. There's a Zumi in the center, and Zumi on the left. He doesn't look quite so young now. We first saw him in 1980, and here he is in 2020. And they had just begun to excavate down. And then you may remember something happened in early 2020, COVID, and everything stopped. So far as I know, they haven't been able to resume excavations here. And there's my sunset picture. This is actually not my picture. Carlos Alera sent me that picture to use in my lectures to end with. And next time you'll see me is a lecture called A Man, a Plan, a Canal, Panama. I've talked with Peter, and we're going to do this actually as two different lectures, maybe one tomorrow or the day after tomorrow when we're in Guayaquil, and then when a sea day before we get to the canal. The first part, part one, is the history leading up to the construction and constructing it up through 1914, and then the second one will be what we'll see as we go through the canal, plus the new constructions that the bigger set of locks. So we'll probably have two sections, look into currents and see when it is, and you'll get figure out when those lectures will be. Thank you.